Thank you for the opportunity to present this talk. First, I'd like to declare that I have no financial interest to disclose. Magnetic resonance imaging has become an indispensable image modality, both in clinical and in research settings, and it is generally considered safe. However, imaging may be restricted or even denied to certain patients with potential contraindications, and that's mainly when there are implants involved. The aging population has led to increasing numbers of people with chronic conditions and also with implanted medical devices, or IMDs. And there are many of those patients, and for many of them also there's an increasing medical indication to perform imaging, either on the pathway to implantation or afterwards for therapy control or in general for further diagnostics. So basically, two different types of IMDs. When there are no powered electronic components present, we call them passive IMDs. And examples are, for example, in neurovascular applications, cranial fixation plates, as shown here, or aneurysm clips and coils. In cardiovascular treatments, stents and stent grafts are common, or valves and catheters. In orthopedy, screws, rods, or total joint anaprotheses are common, like this knee endoprosthesis here. Active IMDs come with powered electronic components. Examples are in neurology, deep brain or spinal cord stimulators, cochlear implants. In cardiology, we have pacemakers and insertable ECG or loop recorders, and others may be drug delivery pumps. Some terminology for those who are not familiar with this, the electronics are in here, which is called CAN or the IPG, implantable pulse generator, and it is then connected to a wire, which is called the lead. So what is the current situation with regard to implants and CMR system? Well, the IEC standard 60601-2-33 says that the MR system manufacturer shall describe all the risks that are associated with scanning patients and with active or passive IMDs in their instructions for use. And that's why we have these big warning signs at our scanner doors. And here, contraindications are all magnetic as well as electrically conductive materials. Everything is prohibited, even the tiniest materials here. However, in the third edition of the IEC standard in 2010, a small statement was included that in case of MR safe or MR conditional implants, the implant manufacturer should inform the MR operator via the instructions of use of this implant about safety and possible conditions that it should take into account for safe imaging. So this opened up a small gap, which actually allowed us to perform imaging in these patients. What is meant with MR safe or MR conditional? We've heard this in the very first part of the session. Well, this is declared in the STM standard here. And MR safe means that an item is known to pose no hazards in all MRI environments. And such items are non-conducting, non-metallic, and non-magnetic. And here, this item may be determined to be MR safe by providing a scientifically based rationale rather than actual test data. MR conditional are items that have been demonstrated to pose no known hazards, but only in a specific MR environment and with specific conditions of use. And the conditions defining the MR environment include static magnetic field strengths, the gradient of the magnetic field, the switch gradient fields, RF, and SLR. Additionally, specific configurations of the item may be required, for example, how you route the leads. MR unsafe items are known to pose hazards in MRI environments, and this includes magnetic items. So you, the MR operator, or basically the radiologist, has to decide if an implant is good, bad, or ugly, or if the patient with the IMD may be exposed to the MR or not. And we do that by looking at the information that's provided by the vendors of the implant. For example, here, a port, and when you look up at this information, you see up to which static magnetic field you can expose this implant, how much heating may occur, and what image artifacts may occur. You can also look this information up at databases like the well-known MRISafety.com, the list here, or also there's another database called macrosource.com where you can search for certain keywords and look up the information about this implant. We can also look up scientific publications. This is quite common at ultra high field strengths, as almost no implant vendor has certified their products for 7 Tesla. Examples are here, for example, a paper about programmable shunt assistant, and other examples are, for example, from the Berlin group. They published a very good paper on RF heating of coronary stents at 7 Tesla, from the Lion group about compatibility of dental retainer wires at 70. And there are also some other publications regarding various implants and their interactions with the static magnetic field. However, you, of course, have to scrutinize the question the quality of these publications and how you can transfer their results to your system. So based on all this, we can now separate if it is a good implant where no risks are expected, if it is a bad one where imaging may be allowed but only with very high precautions, or if it is an ugly one, an absolute contraindication. Good, bad, or ugly can also be seen with regard to the amount of safety testing that is needed, and less with the outcome of such an assessment. And here I'd like to introduce a fourth group, which would be the perfect implant, non-magnetic, non-conducting, non-metallic. And as I said before, here a scientifically based rationale would be adequate to say that this is MR safe. An example is the implant contraceptive, which is a single rod non-metallic subdermal device. Good implants, here simple testing is adequate. Those are typically small implants with no flexible parts and that are at a very defined position, for example, dental implants, as shown here. However, if there's too much dental work in the mouth, this can also turn bad, of course. But also, if you can directly demonstrate that an item is MR unsafe, you may consider this a good one because you're directly done with your safety assessment. Just one demonstration of MR unsafe is enough, whereas just one example of MR conditional may not be. Bad implants need complex testing. Usually, you have to do some pre-tests and also some long-lasting numerical simulations, for example, to find the worst-case scenario. Those are typically large implants, complex structure, and they may also vary in positioning. For example, here, stent grafts, as you can see, the structure is quite complex, and they also look different when they're inflated in the body compared to when you take them out of the packing. Ugly implants need extensive testing and maybe even redesign. So those are large or active implants with long, flexible, conductive parts. An example here is the Medtronic Gravo pacemaker system, which was the very first MR conditional pacemaker system. It took a large group of researchers more than 10 years to bring it on the market. They first had to develop and verify suitable test methods, which then led to redesign, etc. So there were a lot of resources going into that. Yeah, what is meant with small? This is, of course, regard to the wavelengths in human tissue. And as you can see, as you have already seen before, when you go up with magnetic field strengths, the wavelength decreases. And as a rule of thumb, highest heating occurs in the range of quarter to half lambda. For ring-like implants, you should take the circumference, of course, not the diameter. And if there are any capacities or inductions present, then this could be a perfectly resonant microcoil. And it's also not valid anymore. So what are the standards if we have, what are the test tools if we can apply? Well, in 1997, FDA asked American Society for Testing and Materials to develop suitable test methods and guidance to address safety issues for medical devices in the MR environment. And this has led basically to those three standards here regarding displacement force and torque and also induced tissue heating. There's also a fourth standard regarding image quality due to metal-induced image artifacts. However, this is not really safety-related. So let's have a look at all those standards. We start with the very first one regarding magnetically-induced displacement force produced by spatial field gradients on medical devices. This is quite a simple test. You just suspend your device by a string, and then you measure the deflection angle. And if that deflection angle alpha is less than 45 degrees, the magnetically induced displacement force is less than the gravitational force, and it is acceptable or safe to bring this item into the MR environment. Also, for deflection angles larger than 45 degrees, it may be acceptable. It just depends whether this item is well fixated, for example, to the bone or similar. An example is this Wiener Kawa filter here, and in the instructions for use, it says it is safe to use up to a segmented field of 1.5 Tesla and a spatial gradient field of 450 Gauss per centimeter. Yeah, Kugel also mentioned this in his talk. Remember that it is not the switch spatial encoding gradient strength from the gradient coil, or even the slew rate of a gradient coil. It is much more the gradient of the spatial static magnetic field. And of course, we should perform the deflection measurements at the point of maximum deflection, which is given for dia and paramagnetic materials and ferromagnetic materials below the saturation at the point of maximum magnetic field and maximum gradient, whereas for saturated ferromagnetic materials, it's given by the maximum gradient. Unfortunately, you cannot perform these measurements at these points because the field is much too inhomogeneous, and therefore you have to rescale your measurements. So if you measure some 5 degrees at 50 millitesla per centimeter, this then corresponds to 30 degrees at, for example, 300 millitesla per centimeter. Also keep in mind that the spatial gradient fields are different among different systems. So here's a view of a passively shielded whole body 7 tesla magnet. We see a maximum gradient of 8 tesla per meter at the upper part of the cover of the bore liner. Some 5 to 7 tesla per meter gradients where the patient will be exposed to. When we use an actively shielded 7 tesla system, the maximum gradient increases to 11.7 tesla per meter, and the patient will be exposed to 7 tesla per meter, maybe even 10 tesla per meter here. And a 3 tesla system, for example, also has a maximum gradient of 11 tesla per meter here at the entrance of the bore, and patient will be exposed to also some 5 tesla per meter, maybe even 7 tesla per meter. Yeah, strength and location of the maximum gradient vary among systems. However, and the maximum allowed values in the implant instructions for use may be easily exceeded. However, for some MR systems, the location of the reported maximum gradient is quite often inaccessible to the patient, usually behind the covers. Unfortunately, the standard does not specify testing at a fixed magnetic field and fixed gradient, and also the measured deflection angle is currently not reported. This is, of course, a problem. We do not know if it was 5 or 44 degrees, and if there was only minor deflection, we could think about exposing the implant to a stronger gradient and stronger magnetic field. This has also recently been brought up by Emmanuel Canal and colleagues in the journal Radiology. So in this picture, you see that there's not only a displacement force acting on an item, but also a torque that aligns, for example, this pair of scissors to the magnetic field. The maximum magnetostatic torque will be at the isocenter. And according to the standard, you have to measure the torque of each principal axis of the device. For example, such a setup here, you have a turntable. You put your device on this holding platform, which is connected via a torsional spring. And the magnetically induced torque should be less than the worst case torque, which is defined as the longest axis of your, or the longest dimension of your item times gravitational force. So before I introduce the third standard regarding arc-induced heating, I'd like to talk a little bit about the mechanisms of induced heating. As you know, our transmit RF coils not only generate V1, but also local electric fields in the patient. And there are basically two scenarios, worst-case scenarios that can happen, which I'd like to describe here in this example of cranial fixation implants that we have studied for use at 7 tesla. One is that there could be a magnetic flux orthogonal to the implant, leading to a maximum induction of eddy currents on this implant. And second would be for a uniform plane wave with E and H being parallel to the implant, which leads to a greater distortion of the electric field. So the electric field induces surface currents on our implants, which then lead to scattered electric fields near the ends and edges of our implant, and this turns into a local or increased power deposition in the human tissue. A common misconception is that the implant would get hot. This is not the case. It is the local tissue and its connectivity and the induced currents from the scattered electric fields that create ohmic heating. Of course, the metal can take in some of that heat and act as a heat sink. Yeah, this standard, ACM standard for RF-induced heating, F2182, is for passive implants only and for implants that will be entirely inside the body. So if you have any other conditions, for example, and you want to study an external fixation device where parts of the implant are within human tissue and others are outside, you have to modify the standard. According to the standard, you should use such a human trunk simulator here, filled with geline saline solution, given conductivity and permittivity. And as you can see in this image from Eugenio Mattei, it's recommended to also thermally isolate the phantom, to place in a grid to correctly position your implant and your temperature probes. And you should then perform an imaging protocol that generates a relatively high amount of SAR. You should perform imaging for at least 15 minutes and at least 2 watts per kilogram averaged whole body SAR. And you can then measure the temperature increase with fiber optic temperature probes. To perform such a measurement is quite simple. It's very demanding to perform correct and reliable measurements. That is actually the problem. The temperature probes yield only pointwise information about the temperature distribution, so this is quite prone to positioning errors. It also makes a difference how you place your temperature probes close to the implant, for example here, close to tips of pacemaker leads. Here we see the error in our temperature measurements, which can be quite significant when you use a tip-to-side contact compared to a side-to-side or transversal contact here of the temperature probes to the implant. It also makes a difference where you put your implant. So you may heavily underestimate your temperature increase when you put it in the center of the phantom here, whereas you should do it, of course, at a worst-case exposition, which is typically more towards the RF coil. And you can see here that there's a significant difference between temperature increase. Also, how you configure your device, the pathway, for example, for long leads. Here, if you use a straight configuration, this yields different temperature increases compared to when you curl it up like this or in this S-shaped form here. And finally, also the termination. This is data from Deborah Langman. She studied heating of abandoned pacemaker leads. And as we can see here, especially for typical lead lengths of 40 to 60 centimeters, there can happen very high temperature increases when the pacemaker leads were electrically isolated with a plastic cap here compared to when they were directly exposed to gel or still attached to the pacemaker. A similar situation has been reported for hip implants where you can replace the metal head with a ceramic head. Ceramic is MR safe, but this isolation, as in this case, may actually tune your implant to be more sensitive to the RF. So if you change anything well meant with MR safe material, you should redo all these tests here, of course. And just briefly, artifacts, for example, from retainer wires here or from endobuttons to support an artificial ligament. As said, they are not directly safety related, but the artifact size can, of course, have an impact on the decision-making process, whether to perform imaging or not. The test standard recommends to immerse your device in copper sulfate solution. You should use different orientations related to B0 and acquire images with and without the implant present by running a couple of spin and gradient echo sequences where you should change the phase encoding direction and the slice orientation in order to find the maximum artifact size that can happen. So much for passive implants. For active implants, in 2012, the joint working group between the International Standards Organization, ISO, those are the implant manufacturer representatives, and the ISC, those are the MR safety folks, introduced this technical specification, 10970. And as you can see here, there's a huge list of possible hazards and interactions, and it hopefully covers all potential hazards. This technical specification contains test methods that are applicable to a broad class of active implantable medical devices to be used at 1.5 Tesla. It's a huge document, more than 200 pages to read. It also includes numerical simulations now. It is not a standard yet. It might become one in a couple of years. This usually takes some time. And it's more like guidelines how you can set up a safety assessment. For example, for RF-induced heating, a four-tier testing approach is described. Only for very simple devices, you will find in tier one very well-defined test methods, and only a few simulations need to be performed. But the more complex the device gets, the more simulations are needed, and the less defined the methods that are described in TS will be described here. Examples are, for example, simple drug pump in tier one, a more complex drug pump would be in tier two, and stimulators with simple or complex design then in tier three and four. Regarding good, bad, and ugly, well, tiers one and two may be good. Beyond tier two, it gets bad, and tier four assessments are certainly ugly with the amount of time and testing that you need to perform. In this sense, a few words on numerical simulations. Those remarks are also described in the technical specification. Of course, the SR and also temperature distribution will be different whether you use a heterogeneous head model or a homogeneous head or even a very simplified homogeneous phantom. And of course, you should calculate realistic SR distributions and use heterogeneous phantoms. Also, for different models, there can be different SR distributions. And you might say it is probably only 7T stuff, but Manuel Moorbach also showed at 1.5 Tesla that there are differences in the SR distribution, whether you use, for example, here this FETS model here compared to the standard models Duke and Ella. We have a difference of around 20 to 30% in SAR and a threefold difference compared to this teenager boy Lewis here. The other remarks are that in the vicinity of metallic parts, safety tests based on SAR can yield unreliable results. Just imagine that an averaging mass of 10 or even 1 gram is a large volume of tissue with respect to rapidly changing fields from the implant. So what you actually have to do is thermal simulations of the RF-induced heating, and there's a lot of ongoing work to improve these models, for example, from the Minnesota group regarding the heat transfer rate from blood to tissue, or Manuel Moorbach presented temperature-dependent local perfusion and its impact on SAR-induced heating. And in the end, the most important part is certainly also the validation of the numerical model where you base all your information on. Yeah, in the end, I'd like to talk a little bit about issues at ultra-high fields. We've seen that the spatial gradient is similar to 3T systems, but of course the wavelength is much shorter and there will be stronger polarization effects at ultra-high fields. A problem with regard to standardized tests are that there's no integrated whole body RF call at 7T systems. There are only local transmit calls. Most of them are custom made. The only 7T call that may be available to all 7T sites, at least in Germany, is this Nova Medical head call here. However, when we look at local transmit calls, this can actually be also quite advantageous with regard to clearing a patient that has reported an implant. And these are simulations that Andreas performed because we wanted to study rectal cancer patients, and almost every one of them had a port implanted, which is a ring-like structure here with quite a bit amount of metal. And we wanted to see whether we can image these patients when the local transmit receive body coil is positioned on the pelvis here. And as we see in the simulations that Andreas performed, that the maximum SAR remains within the coil volume and is given by the RF coil alone. However, we do see some SAR elevations at the port, but a factor of 100 less compared to what is actually generated underneath the RF coil. So if this distance of 30 centimeters between the implant and the RF coil, we can say that with this coil, at least safe imaging can be performed in these patients here. And 30 centimeters are, as a rule of thumb, a typical distance that most many ultra high field sites require when they clear patients with implants. Of course, local transmit coils is not what we want at ultra high fields, and there are groups working on integrated whole body coils, Minnesota group, and you may want to listen to Stefan Azada's talk on Wednesday, where he presents our first step towards an integrated 8-channel RF coil. However, this will soon be replaced by a 32-channel variant, and as you can see here, this will have a wide coverage in Z direction of 55 centimeters and then impose strong limitations on imaging patients or subjects with implants, of course. Other things to mention are traveling wave effects. We've basically seen this on the image, on the example of the port. Quite common is also to use different excitation modes at ultra high fields. And this makes it also difficult to perform altogether a standardized test method at ultra high fields. An open question is certainly how can we combine different MR conditional accessories, and maybe there's even a, you want to use them in a patient with an implant. For example, the EEG cap or the headphones can be MR conditional, and also direct bags are quite common to use at ultra high fields. And as Andreas showed at last year's meeting, depending on the configuration of your direct beds, they can have a certain influence on the SAR. Yeah, with this, I'd like to sum up with basically this take-home message here, that due to the huge variability of implants and devices, as well as MR systems, so they are open or solenoid magnets, low or high field systems, or single and multi-channel transmission systems, standards should not be understood as wording of the law, which mentions all the details that you need to perform a safety assessment. I think they are more like guidelines, and you should always critically question them and adapt them accordingly to your actual exposure scenario or test scenario. Yeah, and with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention. I'd like to thank Mark, Andreas, and Harald for our regular safety discussions, and Rose Winuk, Gregor Schäfers, and especially Roger Lüchinger, who gave this talk in previous years, for their inspirations. With that, Glück auf for your safety assessments. Thank you.